Do what we've done every Sunday, and we're going to continue to do till we finish our series, and that's read the psalm together. So I'll start reading at verse 1. You read out loud together from verse 1 down to verse 6. Let's read the psalm. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies, and you anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. You know, as we follow the Good Shepherd, we soon discover that all of our needs are met. The theme of the psalm is in verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd. And because the Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want, or Kenneth Taylor in his paraphrase Living Bible renders that, I have everything that I need. I love that. The Lord is my shepherd, I have everything that I need. And we've discovered the areas of need that the Lord meets. We discovered that he provides us rest. In verse 2, he makes me to lie down in green pastures. We discovered that he provides restoration. Verse 2, or verse 3, he restores my soul. And then thirdly, we discovered that he provides me right or righteous paths to follow. Notice that in verse 3, he leads me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Now, this is the transition we need to catch here. When I am in the green pastures, when I'm beside the still waters, when he's leading me in the righteous paths, sometimes those right paths, those righteous paths, lead into a deep, dark valley. And it's just as much in the will of God by the green pastures and the quiet streams as I am when I'm going through or passing through the valley of deepest darkness. I want you to notice it in verse 4. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Now the phrase, the darkest valley, or I walk through the valley of shadow of death, it is a Hebrew idiom for dark and difficult and bitter experiences of life. All the things that make us afraid are included in that Hebrew idiom, the valley of shadow of death. Now, he's not talking just about dying, which is typically the way we view that statement because it says the valley of shadow of death. But in the Hebrew, the word death does not really even appear there. The phrase in the Hebrew is deepest, darkest valley. Does it include death? Yes, that's one of man's great enemies and one of our greatest fears. So it includes death, but it's not exclusive about death. It's talking about the deep, dark, difficult, and dangerous and discouraging valleys that sometimes we find ourselves in, even the bitter experiences of life. When we pass through this time, we do not need to fear or be afraid. Now, I want you to picture the scene. The problem is that when the sheep are in the winter cooler months down into the valleys, as springtime arrives and summer begins to come, the shepherd has to take the sheep through the canyons up into the higher altitudes where the grass is greener. You've heard the expression, the grass greener. He takes us up into the greener grass and it's cooler. So in the hot, warm summer, the shepherd needs to lead the sheep through the canyon up into the higher hills for the green pastures. Now, here's the problem. The problem is the sheep are timid and fearful. And the natural path to get to the mountaintops or the higher plateau areas in the summer months is that you have to go through the canyons. And in the canyons, they're dark, they're difficult, they're steep. Sometimes there's shadows that are being cast. Notice it's the shadow of death. And so we have to pass through these difficult times. And sheep not only are defenseless and timid, but they lack good vision. They don't really see very well. The older I get, the harder it is for me to see. I was telling the doctor, I need a longer arm so I can hold my reading out so I could see it better. He goes, you're getting old. You need glasses. I said, get behind me, Satan. I'm kidding. I didn't say that to my doctor. Remember when you like turned 40 and the doctor said you need glasses and you start crying, you're freaking out. Like heart trauma. That's a valley of deepest darkness, you know. And sheep can't see very well, so they need to have the shepherd near them. They need to hear his voice. And there's all kinds of predators and dangerous creatures that hide in the canyons and in the rocks. And sometimes there's flash flooding, and it's very scary and dangerous. And the timid sheep need the presence of the shepherd to pass through these canyons. That's the imagery there. As the Lord is leading us in righteous paths, those righteous paths go through deep, dark valleys. But we don't need to be afraid because the Lord is with us. We too pass through dark valleys. They are just as much the will of God as the green pastures and the still waters. Now, we love those earlier verses, you know, green pastures, still waters, waters of rest. Oh, that's so awesome. And we picture that in our mind, but now we're in a deep, dark valley and it's scary and there's shadows and we're afraid. Now, the first question I want to ask about verse 4 is, why does our good shepherd allow us to pass through the dark, difficult, and dangerous valleys? In other words, why does God allow sorrow? Why does God allow pain? Why does God allow suffering? Why do we have to go through the difficult, dark periods of our life? Now, the list could be quite lengthy. I've reduced it to 3 categories. I want you to write them down. Number 1, God allows us to pass through the dark valleys to purify us. To purify us. In the book of Job, chapter 23, verse 10, Job says, he knows the way that I am taking. And when he has tried me, I shall come forth as gold. Now, you talk about having trials. And one day, Job woke up and he lost everything that he had. The only thing God left him was his wonderful, encouraging, supportive wife. She said, honey, why don't you just curse God and die? Thank you, sweetheart. I needed that word of encouragement. Job was having a bad day. He was going through a deep, dark valley. But Job said, the Lord gives, the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I love that statement of Job. God gives, God takes, blessed be the name of the Lord. And Job stayed faithful in trusting God through that deep, dark valley. And Job came out of that dark valley like gold refined in the fire. Now, here's the picture, and it's used throughout the Bible. God puts us in the crucible of affliction. And he heats up the fires of trial and testing, so that the impurities, the dross in our life, come to the surface. And as the goldsmith would skim out the dross until he could look into the crucible and see a perfect reflection of his own face, knowing that the metal now had been purified, so God wants to purify us of the dross of sin and selfishness and pride. There's so many things in our lives that God needs to purify, the dross of self and the flesh. And so God will allow us to be put in the crucible of affliction for the purpose of purifying us in order that we might come forth as gold. Now, that goal is that we might be like Christ, like the Master. So the Lord wants others to see the reflection of Jesus himself in our lives. So he allows the trials to purify. As someone said, when through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient will be your supply. The flames will not hurt you. I only design thy dross to consume and your gold to refine. I love that. God's not going to hurt you. He'll never harm you, but he's refining you. Here's the second reason God allows the valleys in our lives: to perfect us. So you might say to purify us. Some say correct us. And then secondly, to perfect us. In Romans chapter 5, verse 3, Paul says, tribulation works what? Patience. Right. Have you ever prayed for patience? Don't do it. I'm kidding. The word patience, by the way, means steadfast endurance. It's not talking about just a passiveness or a complacency. It's talking about a steadfast, strong endurance. The word was actually used when you were in a strong wind. You're walking on a windy day and you had to lean to make progress on a windy day. You ever been walking against strong wind and you're kind of leaning into it as you walk? That's what the word there, patience, was used for. It means a steadfast endurance. So even though the winds are blowing contrary, you're able to persevere, you're able to continue. So God wants to work in your life to purify you, and then secondly, to develop patience, or to perfect you, to make you more like Jesus Christ. Purifies us, perfect us. And when I say perfect, I mean bring us to maturity. And then here's the third category, and that is to prepare us for service. So the valleys are allowed in our life. Now, again, trust me, the list could be a lot longer, and there's a lot of other reasons God allows his people to suffer. Why do bad things happen to God's people? Well, here's three reasons. He wants to purify you, he wants to perfect you, and he wants to, thirdly, then prepare us for service. That's number three. Prepare us for service. You know, I believe the older I get and the longer I'm serving the Lord, the more I'm convinced that God prepares us for what he calls us to do. I believe that sometimes all of life is preparation for sometimes just a few years of ministry. And did you know that your life is not just about you? Sometimes it's about others and the effect your life can have on others and generations to come. But in my mind lately, I've been thinking about, the older I get, the more I'm thinking about that, I just pray that God has used me to be a blessing to my generation. That I can serve my generation. Then the Lord, take me home if he tarries, and someone else God will raise up. But I just want to be faithful. But I also want to be a blessing to my wife and to my children and to my grandchildren. I believe that God uses the valleys, he uses the difficulties, he uses the hardship to prepare us for service. Now, David, who wrote this psalm, actually knew what it was like to go through deep, dark valleys. Remember when he had to hide in the caves from King Saul? And God had called him to be king, but he didn't see any evidence of that. He's sitting in a cave. He's running and hiding with his mighty men. And then it reaches its culmination when they're living in the city of Ziklag, David and his mighty men, and they're hiding from King Saul. And they go off on one of their raids, and when they come back, the whole city's burnt to the ground. And all their wives and all their kids and all their things are gone. That'd be like coming home from work and your house is burnt down and someone kidnapped your wife and your kids. So David just began to grieve and weep and weep. And it says that he wept with his men till there was no more strength in them. And then to make matters worse, David's own men turned against him. And they blamed him for the problem that they were in. And they wanted to stone David to death. But there's a really amazing statement made at this point, this low, dark, discouraging time in David's life. You know what it says? It says, and David encouraged himself in the Lord his God. David turned in the midst of the darkness, and he remembered God's promises. Never doubt in the dark what God has spoken in the light. And he remembered God's presence. And he began to experience God's peace. And he gained new direction for his life. So they suited up and they went out and they overcame. They conquered. They got their wives and their children back. And it was interesting because from that chapter, the very next chapter in the life of David, David is being called back to Jerusalem. Saul, the king, has died. And David's being called back to be the king of Israel. You ever hear the expression, it's always darkest before the dawn? That's so often true. David was at his complete lowest. His men were going to stone him to death, but he turned to the Lord, encouraged himself, and the Lord is God. Now, how would the story have ended if David hadn't done that? I would have said, David was stoned by his own men in Ziklag, and he would lie under a pile of stones. But instead, the story changed because David said, he turned to the Lord, and he trusted in the Lord, and he encouraged himself in the Lord, his God. So it is often darkest just before the dawn, and I believe that God is preparing us for ministry. You know that Moses was 80 when God called him to his public ministry? And that all of his life was preparation for that one time when God would call him to release the people of Israel from their bondage in Egypt. I believe that God allows us, 2 Corinthians chapter 1 says that he allows us to go through sorrow and suffering and pain and hardship so that we can become compassionate and sympathetic and minister to others. You know what I do quite often? Someone comes to me and they say, I was just diagnosed with cancer. I'll find somebody in the church that's gone through what they went through. See that person over there and that guy in that red shirt? Go talk to him. I want you to go tell him I sent him to you. Because they've been through the same thing. Somebody comes up, we're really struggling in our marriage. I say, see that couple over there by that door? I tell them their names. You go talk to them. They've gone through the same marital problems you have, and God's helped them, and God's strengthened them. Oh, I'm out of work. I just lost my job. You see that fellow over there? He's been out of work, and God's provided for him. I want you to go talk to him. God's going to use. You know that God is actually equipping you and preparing you to be used? You go, I don't want to be used. I just want to be comfortable. Don't send anybody to me, Pastor, please. We used to sing years ago, make me a blessing. Make me a blessing. Out of my life, may Jesus shine. You know, if God's going to use you, God's going to have to first break you because he's preparing you to be used by him. So don't despise those times when God's breaking you and making you. He's preparing you. And I believe that many times those deep, dark valleys are just simply preparation for ministry that he's calling us to. So when you're in a deep, dark, and difficult valley, you can say with David, verse 4, I will fear no evil. Now, I want you to note what he says there. He doesn't say, I will feel no evil. David does not say, I will feel no evil. He says, I will fear no evil. David doesn't say, I will not experience evil. We do go through difficulties and hardships. But even though we do, we will not fear or be afraid. Now, the second question we need to ask is, why is it David said he would fear no evil? And why is it that I can go through these deep, dark valleys and not be afraid? Let me give them to you from the text. First of all, we have his presence. I want you to notice it in verse 4. How is it that you can say, David, I will fear no evil? And the answer is in verse 4. For thou art with me. You are with me. David is now talking to the Lord, not about the Lord. There's a little distinction here I want you to see. You can't miss it. Notice it in verse 2. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He, verse 3, restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness. So he's talking, and the personal pronoun there is in the third person. He. But guess what? now that he's in a deep, dark valley? It's you, 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 you. So this is what happens in the psalm. He goes from talking about the Lord to talking to the Lord. He begins to actually talk to the Lord. Now, let me tell you something. You can talk about Jesus when you're by the quiet streams and you're feeding in the green pastures. But when you're in the deep, dark valleys, you start talking to Jesus. Amen? Years ago, I was kidnapped at gunpoint in Los Angeles. Every time I go to L.A., I say, let's go, but don't get kidnapped. I was actually kidnapped at gunpoint and held hostage for several hours, had a gun to my head, and, you know, thankfully the Lord protected us and kept us. But I thought I was going to die. I thought I was going to be shot and carjacked and so forth. They did let us out of the car and take our car. I was with three other pastors. They took our car and drove off, but, you know, they threatened to kill us. And so I know what it's like. My prayer life just took on a whole new dimension. I had never prayed so earnestly, so sincerely, so fervently, so heartfelt, oh God, as in that moment. Not too many years ago, I experienced a stroke and I was put into the hospital. I was in ICU and I literally didn't know if I'd ever preach again. I didn't know what my condition would be or the outcome of that situation. I was on my back. And I would say that was probably one of the, or not the most humbling time in my life. To have a chaplain come in and pray for me and a chaplain come in and encourage me. And I just so humbling. But I'll tell you what it did. Boy, it really revived my prayer life. I began to talk to the Good Shepherd like I'd never talked to him before. And those deep, dark valleys are those moments when we encounter him and we experience him. So we have his presence. It was John Bunyan, the man who wrote Pilgrim's Progress, from a prison in Bedford, England. He said, in times of affliction, we most commonly meet with the sweetest experiences of the love of God. The Lord is with us. We need to fix our eyes on him. It's interesting that in verse 3, he goes before us. He leads me. But in verse 4, now he's beside me. He's beside me. And it's interesting that David didn't say, yea, though I walk through the valley of shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for I have a Visa card. I have a MasterCard. I have a large nest egg. I will fear no evil. I have friends in high places. I have parents that will loan me the money. He didn't say that. He says, it's the Lord who's with me. And he knew that the Lord's with him, being with him, was all that he needed. The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. You know what you need? When you're going through a deep, dark valley, you need the presence of the Lord. You know, as older people whose kids are older and grown, don't you miss having your kids little when you used to get to hold their hands? Don't you love the feeling of a little hand in yours and you're holding their little hand? Well, grandkids. Amen? All the grandparents go praise the Lord. And the other day I was just holding my granddaughter's hand in a crowd, and that was the best thing I had ever done. Just, felt so good. Just to hold her hand and to have her close to me, to know that she was safe. You know, that's the same thing when we go through the deep, dark valleys. We just need to be able to reach out. He's not leading me. He's beside me. And I need to reach up and hold his hand, and I need to hear his voice, and I need to sense his presence, because it's dark and it's scary and there's shadows and I'm worried and I don't know what the future holds. So the Lord allows us to go through those times. But we know that he gives us his presence. And secondly, his protection. I want you to notice it in verse 4. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. Now, what are the rod and the staff? The rod was basically a club. Sometimes they would use a root ball, and they would kind of sand it down, smooth it down, but it'd be a heavy stick of wood with a root ball at the end, and the shepherd could use it as a club. Now, the shepherd didn't use the rod on the sheep. Sometimes we get the idea that he takes us into the deep, dark valley to beat us up. Yea, though I walk through the valley, thou clubbest me there. No, the rod wasn't for the sheep. The rod was for the enemy. It was for the predators. It was for the people who would come to harm the sheep. And that comfort that it brought the sheep to see that protecting rod. And then the staff was the shepherd's crook. And he would use that to catch the sheep and to bring them back on the path. And when he would bring them into the fold at night, they would pass under his crook and he would count them. So it brought them great comfort. The Lord is not only with us, but he will also keep us. He's not only with you, but he's protecting you and keeping you. Isaiah 43, verses 1 and 2, the prophet Isaiah says, "But now thus saith the Lord, that created thee, O Jacob, formed thee, O Israel, fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by my name, thou art mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overflow thee. And when you walk through the fire, they shall not burn you, neither shall the flame kindle upon you." Now, I know that Isaiah is prophesying about Israel, but I do believe it applies perfectly to us, the church. And that we as believers have the Lord to protect us. That he said, "I'll never leave you or forsake you." And that he surrounds us with his care, his care. Number three, we need not fear because we have his provision. And I only touch on this because it's our text for next Sunday, but notice it in verse 5. "You prepare a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. You anoint my head with oil, and my cup," what does it say? "Runs over." That's awesome. So, Lord, your presence, your protection, and your provision. God, you're providing for me. You're filling my cup to overflowing. You know, Jesus said in Matthew 6, verse 25, "Don't worry. Don't be anxious." He said, "Consider the birds. They don't toil. They don't gather in the barns. They don't labor. But your Father in heaven does what?" What does God do for the birds? Feeds them. You ever been to In-N-Out? Seen those French fries laying around? That's divine providence for the birds. You mark my word, you check out those birds, those fast food places, they are fat. Big old honking French fry carrying it around. Take it home and live in a month on one of them suckers. I have to buy them, they get them free. Kind of bums me out. God provides for the birds. And God provides for flowers. You know, Jesus said, not only check out the birds, but check out the flowers. They don't toil, they don't spin. Yet Solomon in all his glory was not clothed like one of these lilies. You seen the flowers on the freeway lately and the roadside, how beautiful it is right now? You know, remind yourself when you drive by those flowers, God clothes those flowers. God will take care of you. O ye of little faith. Someone put it in a little poem, said the robin to the sparrow, "I should really like to know why these anxious human beings rush about and worry so." Said the sparrow to the robin, "Friend, I think it must be that they have no heavenly Father such as cares for you and me." You know, the truth is we do have a Father in heaven, and he does promise to take care of us and to provide. So we don't need to be afraid or fear. God's provision is there. And then fourthly and lastly, in verse 6, and we'll get it in 2 weeks, we have his promise. He says in verse 6, "Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. And when we get to verse 6 in a couple of weeks, we see he abandons all the metaphors and the imagery. It's not a shepherd. He's not a host. It's just goodness, mercy, following me all the days of my life. And I will dwell where? In the house of the Lord forever. You know what that is? That's the promise of heaven. Do you know that God has promised not only to be with you, not only to protect you, not only to provide for you, but God has promised to take you to heaven when you die. That's good news, amen? All this and heaven too. Jesus said it like this in John 14. He said, don't let your heart be troubled. He said, don't let it be afraid. He said, you believe in God, believe also in me. And then he used this expression, in my Father's house, referring to heaven, are many mansions or abiding places. And if it weren't true, I wouldn't have told you. I'm going to go and prepare this place that when I come again, I'm going to receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. What a blessing to know that God is taking me to heaven when I die. Do you have that assurance? Do you know for sure that when you die, you're going to go to heaven? If you've trusted the Lord as your shepherd, you put your hand in the hand of the man from Galilee, you're trusting Jesus Christ, you can know for sure that when you die, you will spend eternity in heaven. And your valley of deep darkness need not bring fear. Now, there's one last point I want to make, and that is that perhaps the deepest, darkest valley that we all, underline the word all, have to pass through is death. When the King James translation says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I believe that it's fine because death is included. And it scares us. The thought of dying and getting old and what happens when I die, it's one of man's greatest fears. It's man's greatest enemy. You know, the Bible teaches in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, that it's appointed unto every person once to die. Did you know you can't escape death? You can avoid taxes. I probably shouldn't tell you that. We'll edit that out. But you can't avoid death. Another scripture says, what man is he who lives and shall not see death? Who is he who can save his soul from the hand of the grave? Good question. We're all going to die. Given enough time, most of us in this room right now are going to be gone. Are you ready to die? Are you ready to meet your Maker? Are you ready to go into eternity? You know, you don't stop living when you die. You still exist, and you either go to heaven or you go to hell. Depends upon where your faith and trust has been in this life. The Bible also tells us that life is short. There's two things that are certain, the certainty of death and the brevity of life. The Bible says that life is like a vapor of smoke that appears for a time and then vanishes away. And it's like a flower that springs up fresh in the morning and then's withered with the noonday heat. But if you're afraid to die this morning, I have good news for you. Jesus Christ, the Lord who is our shepherd, has conquered death. He has taken the sting out of death, and you need not fear death. In 2 Timothy 1, verse 10, it says, Jesus Christ has abolished death and brought life and immortality to light through the gospel. You say, well, Pastor John, how did Jesus do that? He did that by dying for you on the cross. God the Son came from heaven and was conceived in the womb of the Virgin Mary. And he lived a sinless life for 33 years, spoke like no one ever spoke, healed the blind, raised the dead, cleansed the leper, walked on water, calmed the storms. And then he went to a rugged cross that hung on a hill called Calvary. And he laid down willingly because he loves you and me. He died for us, gave his life willingly, voluntarily, as a substitute on the cross for our sin. The death of Jesus Christ was a substitute. He took your place. He died in your stead. Then he was buried, And 3 days later, he rose again. Up from the grave, he arose. And Jesus died for our sins, but he rose for our salvation so that we could be forgiven and free. And he ascended back to heaven, and he lives right now, and he's waiting for you to turn to him and trust him for salvation. You see, salvation isn't by being good, going to church, getting baptized, changing the way you live. Stop doing bad things and God will let you into heaven. The Bible says by grace we are saved through faith, and that not of ourselves. The Bible says that salvation is a gift from God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. When you stand before God on judgment day, you can't say, well, you should let me in because I went to Revival Christian Fellowship. And I endured John Miller's sermons. Anybody that listened to that boring preacher ought to be led into heaven. That's not going to get it. But if you say, I trusted Jesus Christ, I reached out and took his hand. I put my faith in him. I believed in him. The Bible says, for God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten son, that whoever believes in him will never perish, but have what? You don't need to be afraid. God wants to give you a gift today. You can be able to say with David, I will dwell in God's house forever. And if you're here this morning and you say, Pastor Miller, I don't know if I'm saved. I don't know if I'm born again. I don't know if I'm truly a child of God. If there's any doubt at all about where you will spend eternity, do you know that when you die, you're going to go to heaven? Do you know that when you die that you'll have eternal life? I believe you can have it right now as a gift from God if you'll open your heart and receive Christ as Savior. And I'm going to give you an opportunity to do that right now. I don't want anyone to leave this service without being given the opportunity to trust Jesus Christ. And all your fear of death can be gone. And you can have the hope of eternal life. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life, and he that lives and believes in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. So if you haven't trusted Jesus right now, you need to receive him as your Savior, as your Lord. And he'll forgive your sins, and he will give you the hope of heaven when you die. Let's bow our heads in a word of prayer.
If God has spoken to you through this message today, and you're not sure that you're a child of God, maybe you don't know for sure that if you died today that you would go to heaven. You've never really trusted Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now, inviting Christ to come into your heart and to be your Savior. So as I pray this prayer, I want you to repeat it out loud, right where you are, after me. Make it from your heart, inviting Christ to come in and be your Lord and Savior. Let's pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I'm sorry for my sin. I pray that you'll forgive me and come into my heart and make me your child. Fill me with your Holy Spirit and help me to live for you all the days of my life. I believe in you. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. If you prayed that prayer and you meant it, God heard that prayer, and I believe that God will and does forgive your sins. We'd like to help you get started growing in your walk and relationship with Jesus Christ. God bless you.
If you just prayed with Pastor John to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we are so excited for you. And we'd like to send you a Bible and some resources to get you started in your relationship with the Lord. Simply click on the contact link at the top of the page and tell us something like, I prayed to accept Christ. We'll get your Bible and resources mailed out to you right away. God bless you and welcome to the family of God.